the leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If you're vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
All right, folks, this is Rick Robinson with you. I want to tell you about some friends of mine from a company called Security Enforcement Specialists. When I ran my security agency for 12 years, I worked with one of these partners on a daily basis. He's been involved in this agency now, and with his other partner, they do have over 30 years of experience in the private security industry. If you own a business and you need someone to keep you or your customers or residents safe, then I highly recommend contacting Security Enforcement Specialists today. Give them a call at 405-703-1796. Again, that's 405-703-1796. Again, tell them Rick from K98 Talk sent you. Like I said, if you need the help, they are here for you. So make sure that you go look them up, check them out, and see what they can do. The wrong way. Welcome to the place.
J.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't gonna be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
The Internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Whoa! Good God, y'all.
What is it good for?
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Thanks for being with us. It is Monday, the 14th of December in the year of our Lord, 2015. It's Monday. That means that I'm Kevin Wade, sitting behind the microphone, and in the studio with me is none other than our show's inspirational leader and founder here at the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, Rick Trader. Rick.
Kevin, great to be with you again, and I just want to publicly thank you and your beautiful wife and your daughter for a wonderful time Saturday night at your home celebrating Christmas. And Mary and I spent the day in Newcastle, old historic Newcastle, which for anybody within the sound of the broadcast range of WNJC 1360 in eastern Pennsylvania, southern Jersey, northern Delaware, if you've not been to old Newcastle, you've got to make a trip. Old Newcastle, it's like going back to the 1700s.
And but with air conditioning.
But with air conditioning. And Saturday, Old Newcastle had a Dickens Day, we could call it, and it was just a festive atmosphere, music, concerts.
People walking around in costume.
It was a beautiful day. And by the way, for it to be December the 12th, and to be able to walk around in a short sleeve shirt, if you
want
to.
Some had short pants on as well.
Some had short pants. It was just an absolutely beautiful day. We thoroughly enjoyed it. And Kevin, I also want to say we made our way to your church, the United Methodist Church there in Newcastle, and heard a splendid concert. Splendid concert provided by a choral director and the Westfield Chorale.
Out of New Jersey, out of the Garden State.
Terrific voices. And Kevin, I've mentioned to you before, and I just want to mention here on the radio that Mary and I love to do that type of thing at Christmas time, to go to different churches and hear different choirs and choruses. And the Westfield Chorale, they were spectacular, probably the best I've ever heard in a church setting like that.
It was remarkable, and I had tears in my eyes just at the simple beauty of some of the hymns and carols, both religious and secular, they were singing. Tremendous voices and a true testament to the goodness of their director, mm-hmm. Bill Wright, who's retired now from teaching, but for many years he taught music in New Jersey. And he mentioned to me in passing, because he now is the music director at our small church, that he had been invited to attend a wedding in Pittsburgh a wedding in which one of his former students was one of the participants. And that struck me that he must have left a lasting and good impression to be remembered in on that wedding invite list. And when I saw the number of great voices who journeyed to our little church to put on this spectacular music presentation, well, I'll tell you, you're lucky in life to run into some just really good people. And, and Mr. Bill, as we call him, he's one of them.
And also there was a teacher that did a rendition or a part of Charles Dickens' Christmas Carol.
In character
In voice. He was phenomenal. He like played three parts all in one. One person doing three parts, and he was spectacular. Anyway, we just had a wonderful day. Mary and I had a wonderful day. And on the way home in the car, we were talking about, gee, what day is it going to fall on next year? Because we're definitely coming back. Even if you don't invite us, we're coming back, Evan.
Now, if you've seen renditions of Dickens' Christmas Carol, either on stage or various TV and movie presentations, I have to say none of them got the voices right. The fellow who was in part of the presentation on Saturday afternoon in our church, he had the voices right.
He was phenomenal. Kevin, you know, Christmas Eve and Christmas fall on a Thursday and Friday this year. And
those are days where we normally broadcast the Conservative Commandos
Absolutely.
Radio show.
Absolutely. But we will not be doing our normal shows that day. Instead, I'm editing together a special Christmas show. Part of that show will be Bible readings. Part of that show will be Christmas music, Christmas songs, Christmas carols. And you know, we are a political show, Kevin. So I'm also including in that show a lot of our favorite Christmas political parody songs. So I mention this because I want to invite our listeners, if they have a favorite, please send it to me. You can contact me at rick@conservativecommandosradioshow.com, or you can contact me through Facebook, Rick Trader, or through the Conservative Commandos Radio Show Facebook group page. But if you have a favorite Christmas parody, please send it on to me, because we would love to include it into our Christmas shows.
Well, let us never, ever forget the meaning in the season, and that is the birth of Jesus, who revealed himself as the Christ during his missionary time on this planet. And many Christian churches recognize this particular time of the month as part of the Advent season, to look ahead, to anticipate. And in a world that's so beset by violence and unspeakable troubles, brutality, I mean, the message of Christmas, peace on earth, goodwill to all men, is as evergreen as it was that first night when the shepherds were minding their flocks.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Kevin, you know, we're also going to have things like, for instance, and you and I were talking about this earlier today. I guess it was in 1968, I do believe.
67 or 68, probably 68.
68. Christmas Eve. The Apollo 8 astronauts circling the moon, reading from the book of Genesis. And you and I were talking about how we were moved. And for our audience who's never heard this, please turn into our shows on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, to think that here are three American astronauts circling the moon on Christmas Eve, reading from the book of Genesis, circling the moon that people had looked on for thousands of years in wonder. And here it is, Christmas Eve, they're circling the moon, reading from the Bible. I mean, what does that tell you about a wonderful country this was at that time? I don't know, you could do the same thing today, Kevin. I would hope that someday that we would get a president that would allow our astronauts, would encourage our space program to do something like that, but I'll never forget it.
No, I don't think the heart and soul of the country has changed. I think that some people at the top have deceived their way to the top and are seeking to impose, not lead, but to impose their own views, and some of these views are quite twisted, on the heart of the nation, but this nation is like a mighty river, and it is not unduly influenced by any short-term disturbance. It'll return to its flow after the mistake in the White House leaves in January of 2017.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Kevin, I know you're going to have a commentary for us today.
Yeah, I'll be talking about the safety of American families, and I'll open with a discussion of Angela Merkel, the Mutti, as they say in English, Mama of Germany, and her recent announcements. So that's coming up just after the break in about a minute and a half, I guess.
Yeah. Well, let's quickly run down the guests, and then right after our break, you can go right into your commentary. Who will you be speaking at 3:35?
Well, at 3:35, I have D. Scott Mann, and he spent 23 years with the Army Special Forces, involved in foreign internal defense, counterinsurgency, and stability missions all over the world. D. Scott Mann has a unique and particular set of skills. And he's going to be talking about a new definition, a need for a new definition of terrorism in America. And he brings a professional and experienced eye and judgment to this discussion. That's at 3:35.
All right. At 4:05, we're going to be speaking with Christopher Koopman, who's a research fellow with the Project for a Study of American Capitalism at the Mercatus Center. And he and a fellow of his at the Mercatus Center have done a report, a very interesting report, evaluating the growth of the 1099 workforce, a new phenomena in our country today.
And then at 4:35, in closing up this first show of this week, we have Larry Pratt, and he's a returning guest. He's been the executive director of Gun Owners of America for over 30 years. GOA, Gun Owners of America, is a national membership organization of about 300,000 Americans dedicated to promoting the Second Amendment freedoms to keep and bear arms. And, well, he's going to come in and talk about Hillary doubles down with President Obama, saying that he doesn't want a war with the Islamic State, but he seems to be taking a strategy of a war on honestly held American guns. Mm-hmm. That's Larry Pratt at 4:35.
Okay. Great
and
show.
With that, Rick, let's go into the first break. We're coming to you live from the Conservative Commandos Radio Network Studios, WNJC 1360 AM. Our flagship station in Philadelphia and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio Network, and AM/FM 24/7, theallinn.com. I'm Kevin Wade. In the studio with me is Rick Trader. And you stay with us. We'll be back in about 3 minutes.
I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
He is, and you are. I'm Kevin Wade. It's Monday, the 14th of December. I'm in the studio with the show's inspirational leader and founder, Rick Trader, and to my left, working the soundboard, the infamous Matteo. The sound engineer who only needs one name, Matteo. And if you had the name Matteo, that's plenty.
I wouldn't call him infamous. I would call him famous. This is quite a young man that works with us on Mondays.
Thanks.
To which Matteo says thanks. He's a man of few words, but eloquent. What's on the radar screen news-wise, Rick?
Kevin, I have been quite busy today, and I got to be honest with you, I have not been following the radar screen that closely today. We had some technical issues here at WNJC 1360, which I had to come down and to help get rid of those bugs, but I understand you have some very interesting news about Bo Bergdahl.
Bo Bergdahl, the soldier who left his fellows in an advanced position in Afghanistan and disappeared for 4 or 5 years, and was then traded by the President Obama administration for five basically terrorist generals, is apparently facing a court-martial, a general court-martial, on charges of desertion. Desertion in the face of the enemy carries with it a very, very grave and serious consequences should he be found guilty by a panel of officers in that court-martial. So I think this is appropriate. I believe that justice will be done, and I hope that the officers sitting as jurors in that court-martial will remember their oath to the service, as well as their need to maintain the esteem that the public holds for the United States Army, and finds themselves unaffected by what I think would be political pressure from the quote-unquote commander-in-chief.
And Kevin, you hear a lot about how the five that were traded for Bergdahl have gone back to the Middle East and now are involved with organizations like ISIS. Gee, does that surprise anyone?
No, it doesn't surprise anyone who doesn't live at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, or it doesn't surprise anyone who's not a Democrat campaigning for that job and that residence. First of all, the country has a long tradition of not negotiating with terrorists under any circumstances, because negotiations themselves will spur other attempts to kidnap and hold hostage. And apparently President Obama did not get the memo on the long-term consequences of that action.
And it turns out that Bo Bergdahl, in terms of opinions given by his fellow soldiers who served with him, was not the model soldier.
Kevin, just before you get into the commentary, I just want to comment on the Bo Bergdahl thing. For 45 days, thousands of soldiers toiled in heat, dirt, misery, and sweat, almost with no... And this is from the New York Times. It's not coming from some conservative post. This is the New York Times. Sweat with almost no rest, little water, little food to try to find Bo Bergdahl. In those operations, six Americans were killed. Six Americans were killed to try to find this guy. Come to find out, he turned himself over to the enemy. He wanted to be one of them. He came back here after, as we've been talking, being traded for five high-ranking terrorists. We traded to get this guy back. Finally, the right thing might be done. Court-martial for Bo Bergdahl. But the damage this man has done, six American lives.
Irreversible, six lives lost.
And the five that he was traded for that are back over in the Middle East now, that are working with Al-Qaeda, that are working with ISIS. What a disaster. The American people need to wake up and realize who is responsible for all that. Barack Obama.
Let me move to, let's talk about safety, the safety of American families. That's the title of my commentary today, Rick. Angela Merkel, the Mutti, as we say in English, Mama, of Germany, announced she is throwing in the towel on Islamic migration to her country. In her words, the German chancellor said there will be a drastic reduction in immigrants entering. Unfortunately for Mutti and her people, she can't unring the bell. The damage is severe from the uncontrolled and almost unlimited entry to her society of a culture so unlike the modern German people. Everywhere in Europe, right-of-center political parties are gaining strength. The governing politicians of the left have moved over time to extreme positions far out of touch with the common sense concerns of their very own constituents. This is shown in the all-tolerant folks of Sweden, where the foreign minister has stated the influx of Middle Easterners must stop. Holland is a small but prosperous country known for its historic centuries-old tolerance for refugees. Even there, the kind-hearted Dutch have finally found a consensus that their society has reached its limit of Islamic people who refuse to become either tolerant or Dutch. France is a strongly secular nation built on the principles of liberty, fraternity, and equality. There, too, is a Muslim community long established that has produced escalating and brutal violence and a rejection of national values and a refusal to become French. In the United Kingdom, France, Belgium, and other countries, there are no-go areas where the police don't enter. In fact, they can't enter it, for it's not the laws of Britain or France or Belgium that are obeyed and enforced in those areas. It is instead the law of the Quran, Sharia law, that governs in these densely populated islands of Islam. The same story of division from the majority, hostility toward national values and oppression of others, especially women within their own communities, that plays out across Europe wherever concentrations of Muslims are dominant. These are the lessons that Western Europe teaches us now in the present. Many would like this not to be true. They believe that the melting pot of pluralistic compassion will sooner or later remove the hard edges of any new arrival or newly arrived group. We all have the same wants and needs. We all understand the same basic desires for human rights and human dignity. Don't we? There is a strain of Islam that rejects these Western concepts of tolerance.
Instead, the followers of those teachings of Muhammad find their lives only have meaning when pursuing his will to master and subjugate all human beings under the yoke of their faith, Islam. This is a vital and growing strain of the Muslim world that has not been mediated by higher education or rising family income or ready access to social benefits or day-to-day examples of peaceful coexistence with a variety of people who simply see things differently. It is not the great majority of Muslims, but it is this vital and growing strain who have declared war on civilization. Wherever they raise their head and their flag, there is violence. From New York City to San Bernardino to Paris to London to Mumbai and to Nairobi. This fact is indisputable. Against this present-day reality, Donald Trump has stated that we need to suspend inbound migration from the world of Islam until, and I quote, our government can figure out what is going on, unquote. This provokes a firestorm of objections by other political figures in America. Yet I ask those who condemn Donald Trump a few questions. What lesson do you learn from the attacks in Paris? What message do you hear from the Swedish foreign minister? Do you want no-go zones of Sharia law to appear in U.S. communities? How can you discern who is and who is not a member of that violent strain of Islam? Finally, and most importantly, what is your plan to protect the lives and safety of the American people? When you have answered these questions, then you may criticize Donald Trump. For too many and increasing numbers of Americans, Trump is the only voice who puts American families and their safety first. I'm Kevin Wade, and that's the way I see it, Rick.
Kevin, great points, great questions. And you know, when you talk about what Merkel did, Merkel opened the barn door, okay? Instead of letting the horses out, she let the horses in. In my opinion, she has done unrepairable harm to Germany and to Europe. That'll go on forever. What I'm concerned about is just to our north. Just to our north, we have a Canadian Prime Minister, Trudeau, who has openly said that he is opening his doors to these refugees coming out of Syria. Again, not knowing who any of them are. I saw a wonderful documentary last night on PBS on Frontline. It was a documentary, The Rise of ISIS. And I invite everyone to please Google this. You can go online and watch this. The Rise of ISIS. Where they come from, how were they allowed to grow? One of the interesting points that was made in this documentary is ISIS observes no border. They observe no borders. They will cross anybody's borders. And that is what they say. In my opinion, that is not only is frightening, but it should be a warning to us. Do you remember about a year ago, Kevin, there was a huge Ebola scare in this country? What did Barack Obama do? Instead of isolating that crisis, that disease, where it was in Africa, no. Barack Obama opened our borders, our doors, to these sick people and brought people here to the United States with Ebola. Fortunately, that didn't get out of control.
Well,
but I see
it,
a very
it, it
similar...
for the guy who died, and also for the nurse who was infected, even though she followed what were known as the state-of-the-art procedures at the time. Again, Rick, what they do is they experiment. They kind of throw the dice.
But it's not their lives at stake. It's your life and my life and Mateo's life and our friends and family.
But I wanted to make this quick point because we got to go to a break. I believe that Barack Obama is doing the same thing with these refugees. He's opening our borders. He's opening a Pandora's box. Once Pandora's boxes are open, you can't reshut him. He can't get the worms back in the can. Kevin, got to go to break.
We're coming to you live from the Conservative Commandos Radio Network Studios, WNJC 1360 AM, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio Network, and AM FM 24/7. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader. We have our first guest coming up in just about 3 minutes.
I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with Kevin Wade and yours truly, Rick Trader. And for rebroadcasts of our shows, check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com, or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to the Leading Edge Radio Network.com, at 1 p.m., roarradio.net, and at 2 p.m., at 2 p.m., highplainsdailynews.com. And you could also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. You don't need an app. You don't need to download anything. Just write down that number and call it. Try it right now. 832-999-1199. 9-9. Kevin Wade, we do have our first guest with us, and will you please make the introduction?
I'll be glad to, Rick. A D. Scott Mann has spent his 23-year Army Special Forces career involved in foreign internal defense, counterinsurgency, and stability missions all over the world. Scott has served in the Special Operations Community for over 18 years and has been a Green Beret for over 15. During that time, Scott spent over 10 years in the 7th Special Forces Group Airborne, where he served in a variety of foreign internal defense and combat deployments. Since retirement, Scott founded and is the Chief Executive Officer of the Stability Institute, a nonprofit organization dedicated to brokering knowledge and connecting stability professionals on complex stability issues around the globe. And with that, D. Scott Mann. Scott, welcome back to the CCRS, Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you, my friend. You've got a column, and the theme is we need a new definition for terrorism in America. Walk me through this, if you would.
Yeah, well, I was reading all of the different reports that were coming out of the San Bernardino shooting, right? You know, it took us 72 hours to even come to any kind of remote conclusion that this was ISIS or some form of Islamist violent extremism. And if you go back and you look at my tweet at D. Scott Mann, I tweeted within literally minutes of just sorting out three basic facts of the way this thing went down, to include the efficiency of the shooting and the way they got away, that, you know, I pretty much called it out right then. And I'm not touting it. I'm just saying we wasted 3 days, you know, trying to determine whether or not this was quote unquote terrorism. And really we should have been using that as a way to get in front of the next one. And I think that's part of the problem, is we're so politically correct, guys. We just spend all our time after the effect trying to determine whether or not it was terrorism when we know it was, and we lose time on the next event.
Scott, let me interrupt you for a second. This is Kevin Wade. Now, what was it that you picked up on so quickly? Why did you not just assume this? I mean, this could have been a workplace. Someone snapped at work. It could be a love triangle gone bad. It could be someone who was just psychotic and they stopped at a random address. I mean, what was it that drew your eyes to the fact that this was terrorism?
Well, you know, for me, Kevin, first of all, that's a great question. And it wasn't just the event alone. Actually, what I try to do, and I would encourage Americans to do, is actually step back and don't look at these events in isolation, but look at them, you know, it as a trend, or look at them holistically as they've occurred, not just in the U.S., but globally. I mean, you had the Paris attack. You had the failed attempts in Europe that were thwarted. You had the November 24th ISIS propaganda video called No Respite. And if your listeners haven't watched that, I suggest you Google it. But it tells us that basically they're kicking off a campaign right now and exactly what they're going to do. And then you had this reporting of this mass shooting by two personnel, assault weapons, quick getaway, nobody on scene, no shooters on scene. And that told me right there, yeah, this is definitely a targeted hit. And it wasn't, you know, it wasn't some amateur hour. But yet, when we actually go over the findings, everybody, all the police and everybody, they equivocate it and make it sound like it was a lone wolf attack. And I just think that's a dangerous equivocation to make these days. These locally radicalized folks are how the next cataclysmic attack is going to come. It's not going to be, I don't think, from some distant Pakistani tribal area. I think these folks are going to be trained, radicalized, and launched from right here in the U.S.
And what are your thoughts about the Saudi bride, so to speak, the fiancé who entered so quickly on, I guess it's called a Type K visa?
Yeah, it's them running the gaps, right, or shooting the scenes. That's what they're doing, and they do it very well. I think this, you know, ISIS, more so than probably Al-Qaeda, are really adept at the next generation of terror. They know how, it's a global system where they have online storytelling and radicalization. They have the local ability to spot, assess, and recruit in mosques right here in the U.S. And then, yeah, look at how they can actually deliver, you know, kind of a ready-made fighter or operative using our visa system through marriage. And I just don't think stuff like this should surprise us anymore. I think what we should look at is these guys are cunning, ideologically committed, and they will exploit our open civil society at every turn. And if we continue to wring our hands, tell ourselves it's not happening, and take 3 days to determine that this was indeed a violent extremist attack, they are going to they're just getting started.
Now, Scott, you used the phrase "our civil society." We hope and pray for a civil society, but in a civil society, innocent people are not slaughtered at the hands of Islamic terrorists. So what can we do, in your opinion, to restore, resume our pleasant way of life in a civil and safe society? What needs to be changed at the top?
Yeah, it's such a great question. And it's obviously, it's a range of things deeper than this phone conversation. But in my book, Game Changers, which I recommend your folks take a look at, I talk about, you know, the top-level policies. We need, obviously, a better home game and an away game. I don't believe that either the Bush administration or the Obama administration really got this thing right. What I'd like to see as far as an away game, if you really want to disrupt these guys and make it harder for them to come into the United States, we need to do a better job of hitting them in their safe haven, of killing them in their safe haven. But dropping bombs, drone strikes, even large troop formations, Kevin, is not going to get it done. It actually mobilizes recruits and jihadists against us. It really comes from working from the inside out with advisors like Green Berets and others who mobilize tribes and clans in these safe havens to push them out. Now, that's the away game. The home game, we obviously need to relook our visa, our whole immigration policy, and I'm not even against some draconian measures to shut down our borders, but I don't think we can, you know, say no Muslims allowed. I don't think that's an enforceable one, nor do I think it's prudent in terms of a narrative. But I do think we can look at points of origin from where foreign fighters are coming from, like Pakistan, and we can shut that down for a while until we sort this out. But right now, we're not making any moves to secure our border to our south or even just revamp our horribly organized immigration system. So let's start with that.
Hey, Scott, we're going into a break right now. Would you stay with us so we can continue this conversation on the other side?
You bet.
We're on the phone with D. Scott Mann. He spent his 23 years in Army Special Forces career, involved in foreign internal defense counterinsurgency, and he's got some meat and potato ideas to get ahead of this game called the War on Terror that is proven so deadly right here in the homeland. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader. We're going to take a short break. You stay with us. We will be right back.
They say I'm crazy. I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet,
We're coming to you live from the CCRS studios. WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Hey, thanks for staying with us. You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our websites, www.ccrsnetwork.com and www.ccrshow.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com, or at 1 p.m., log on to www.roarradio.net, R-O-A-R, radio.net. And for you late risers, log on to highplainsdailynews.com. That's a new one here. And you can listen to the Conservative Commandos from any telephone on the planet by calling 832-999-1199. Some toll charges may apply. We have, as our first guest here in this first day of the broadcast week, D. Scott Mann, 23 years with special operations career involved in foreign internal defense. And he's got some meat and potato ideas how we can win this war on terror. Scott, thank you for staying with us.
You know, it's my pleasure, guys, and it's really an honor to be here, and thanks for what you're doing. It's your platform, really, that's going to mobilize people in 2016. That was the other thing you asked me what we can do, and I tell you right now, it's going to be the American people that are going to demand that our politicians on both sides of the aisle take this enemy seriously. Right now, I still don't think that we're taking them seriously, and I don't mean just the Obama administration. I think we need to overhaul a lot of politicians in Congress as well, and get some folks in there that are going to fight this thing.
Well, if you've ever visited, Capitol Hill, and I'm sure you have, Scott, the security they have, the Capitol Hill police and the metal detectors, it's unbelievable. But in my village, we don't have that. And in Rick's village, he doesn't have that either. And in San Bernardino, in the suburbs, eastern suburbs of L.A., they didn't have that either. So someone needs to start speaking about the life and the safety of our kith and kin, our own families, right here, and stop being so darned academic about some global power struggle. Scott,
I agree. It's so well said.
Scott, my co-host, Rick Trader, has a question for you.
Scott, thanks for being with us today. We appreciate your time. Scott, in your article, and you and Kevin were talking earlier about this idea of lone wolf, self-radicalized, homegrown. What gets me is how the government uses these terms almost to legitimize or to lessen them as any kind of a threat. But it seems to me these people, call them what you want, get their ideas from somebody, and that somebody happens to be a radical Muslim entity overseas.
Oh, you're absolutely right, and it infuriates me to see them equivocate, you know, especially law enforcement officers, and not all of them do it, but the ones that are trying to keep their job at the senior level certainly do, and they almost make it sound like, well, you know, it's really not a threat, because they're lone wolves, and we're not even sure if ISIS directed this. I mean, are you kidding me? I mean, if you can execute 14 people in the way that they did it and make your getaway, and you have an IED factory, mm-hmm. a homemade bomb factory in your apartment, you are a full-fledged violent Islamist extremist. And the thing is, guys, not only nowadays can you get radicalized online and locally, you can get trained. I mean, this was a tactically proficient mission. I've been doing this my whole life. And the way these guys executed this was very tactically proficient. And that's what worries me about this, is that we, like you said, Rick, we dismiss, you know, as if it, you know, makes it a lone wolf. It's like, well, that's all right. It's just, they're just kind of wannabes. And these guys aren't wannabes. This is the new face of terror. When our water supply and our schools get hit, it'll be these guys that do it, not the radicals from overseas necessarily.
Scott, also in your article, you talk about the wife, Tashin Malik, posted pledges to ISIS leader Baghdadi on Facebook. Scott, I was in Facebook jail myself for 2 days for using one word. And that one word was Nazi. Now, I got put in Facebook jail for using the word Nazi, but this person goes on and pledges her allegiance to ISIS. And, you know, and then the FBI, being pressured by the Obama administration for 3 or 4 days not to call this terrorism.
So, yeah, I actually had several news organizations out of New York City, I'd love to tell you who they were, actually asked me before I came on, and again, this was about a day after the fact, asked me not to speculate in any way that this was Islamist violent extremism. And I just told them, look, if you want somebody to come on and tell you how to duck and cover, you know, go talk to the local bomb squad. I'm not your guy. Mm-hmm. So I just went down to the Army ROTC today, and you know, my son is getting ready to take his oath and follow the path of a Green Beret. You know,
God bless your son.
23 friends in this war, and I, you know, I'm just not going to sit here and take this absence of leadership. My nonprofit, Mission America, mm-hmm. my book, Game Changers, we're focused starting in January. We're going to bring to the American people all over the country what we're calling our Victory Garden Tour. We're going to go city to city, and I'm going to do town halls on my own, and we're going to talk to Americans about what ISIS is, what the threat is they pose to us, and how, as a community, we can actually protect ourselves, and how we can consider politicians worthy or unworthy of our vote in relation to violent extremism. And no one is having that kind of conversation with the folks, but you know what? We're going to have it.
Well, if you come near to Philadelphia area, Scott, I sincerely hope you visit us here at the Conservative Commandos Radio Network and WNGC. Hey, Scott, you also mentioned in your article, they brag about how they're goading us into dropping bombs that cost $250,000 to knock out pickup trucks. I just saw a documentary last night, Scott. I was talking to Kevin about it. It was a PBS Frontline documentary about the rise of ISIS. And it shows on there how we're using $250,000 bombs to knock out a pickup truck. I mean, this, you see this as a way to fight a war against ISIS?
It's not. In fact, in my book, Game Changers, in chapters 1 through 3, I make a very compelling case of not, you know, even the Bush administration, and I think they meant well. But guys, I'm going to tell you something. I was in that campaign all the way through, and in 2005, did you know we were spending $16 million for every Taliban we killed in Afghanistan? $16 million. That's insane.
Just pay them off.
You become fiscally insolvent. And Bin Laden bragged right after 9/11 on a video. He said, I can go to any place in the rural areas of Afghanistan, raise a piece of cloth that says Al-Qaeda, and all the American generals will come. These guys know how to play us. And here's the thing. If your listeners want to really get keen on what's going on, watch that No Respite video by ISIS dated November 24th. And you'll see that what they're ideologically committed to, guys, is the return of the prophet, is the apocalypse. And that means they have to goad us into this big set-piece battle in Syria. Now, they believe this. So they're going to visit unspeakable acts of violence on our shores so that they will get us emotionally drawn into a 9/12-type response. It's in their playbook. So we can't just play into another, you know, hey, let's go get those guys. We've been going to get those guys for 15 years, and it's failed. We got to get smarter on where they're really vulnerable and work bottom up. My book completely lays it out. It's not theory. We did it in the remote areas of Afghanistan and Iraq. It'll work, but we've got to get some political leaders in there that got the gumption to do it.
And it takes a long-term commitment. This isn't going to be a three-month campaign in your home by Christmas. It means that you're going to be living with the tribesmen. You're going to be bonding with the tribesmen. You're going to be meeting their needs so that you can amplify your own skill sets with those who know the terrain and the trails.
You're all over it. And, I mean, it's less blood, it's less treasure, it's letting the resilient leaders of these areas do the fighting, most of the fighting, and they will, because they don't want these guys in there any more than they want us. But they will work with us if we can help them push them out, especially if our narrative is we're going to leave when we're done. But absolutely, it will take longer. It won't be one-on-one administration. I mean, we've been working in Colombia for 30 years. I mean, how long has it taken to finally turn that place around? And Afghanistan, Iraq, the places where our enemies set up shop, it's going to take longer. And a lot of people say, well, we don't have that much time. Really? How much time do we have? Because if we don't go in there and work at those local levels, who do you think will?
Scott, I want to ask you a question. I want to take go in a slightly different direction. I mean, you're a guy who's been thinking in your bunk for all these different years. You love this country.
Right.
How do we as a people reconcile the need for safety and security in the homeland with our beloved freedoms? I fear that people in political power will use these events to begin to surveil 300 million Americans when they want to focus on 300,000.
That's such a good question, and it's such a hard problem. You know, what I've been doing? I've been talking to World War II, folks from the World War II generation. I just had a conversation with my dad, just had another conversation with a gentleman out in New Mexico and several others here where I live in Tampa that were alive during World War II, because to me, you know, that was a time when we faced, you know, and I'll use the Nazi word. I think these guys, ISIS and Al-Qaeda, are modern-day Nazis. They are the Tolkien's version of real-world orcs, you know, and so I think this, you know, that was the last time we faced an enemy this horrific. Also, I think it was, you know, a time when Americans were all in. You know, think about the Victory Gardens and where we actually grew our own food, 9 to 10 million tons, so that the government could ship the food overseas to the boys, and it really made an impact. It was equal or greater than the food that the government actually commercially grew and shipped over. But then at the same time, my dad and others were like, you know what, we were putting Japanese civilians in internment camps, and that we don't ever want to go down that road again. So I'm thinking, is it Victory Gardens or is it internment camps? And I'm choosing the former. I think one of the things we've got to do as a nation, guys, is we've got to get back to this level of internal trust at a community level and rebuilding trust in our communities and our society from the bottom up, and stepping up with leadership at our level, teaching our kids about leadership and trust and how it can bridge over ethnic lines, and getting back to our history and just standing for our communities. I just don't see that anymore. And for me and all my fellow veterans, it makes us sad, you know, because I don't want to hand this country over to my son and my other two boys when we can't even trust ourselves. And I think it starts with us and our communities and our schools. And maybe that's a cornball answer, but I just believe it.
No, it's the right answer, as I see it. Website, book, contact information for our audience before we wrap.
You bet. So please go to therealmissionamerica.org. to find out about our Victory Garden tours that are coming your way in January. That's therealmissionamerica.org. If you'll go to thegamechangersbook.com, gamechangersbook.com, that's where you can get the book in all kinds of varieties. It makes a great Christmas gift, and all my proceeds go back to Mission America. And you can follow me on @dscottman at Twitter. I do a lot of posting there on this thing, and I'm just happy to be with you guys. And if I can ever be of service to you, please let me know.
We will. I'll be in contact with you before the week is out. D. Scott Mann, thank you so much for being with us on the Conservative Commandos Radio Network.
It's my pleasure. God bless you guys and Merry Christmas.
God bless and Merry Christmas to you. You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network show. This is being broadcast from WNJC 1360 AM, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio Network, and AM, FM 24/7. They all end in .com. I'm Kevin Wade. In the studio with me is Rick Trader. We're going to take a short break. We want you to be with us on the other side when we come back.
Heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters morning show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485-9907. 904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCS for automation.com. That's PCS, the number four, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. It is Monday, the 14th of December. I'm Kevin Wade, joined in the studio by our show's inspirational leader and founder, none other than Rick Trader.
Kevin, great to be with you again.
It's always great to be working the microphones together. Just had a great, great interview with D. Scott Mann, 20-plus years with Special Forces, and he has some bread-and-butter ideas how to turn this war on terror setback around. That all starts with fresh leadership. Next up, and I think you'll enjoy this, Christopher Koopman is a research fellow with the Project for the Study of American Capitalism at the Mercatus Center at George Mason University. He specializes in regulation, competition, and innovation with a particular focus on public choice and the economics of government favoritism. I might call that crony capitalism. His research and commentary have appeared in the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, Bloomberg, NPR, and the Daily Beast. He's also a contributor at The Hill. And with that, Christopher Koopman, welcome to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Thank you so much for having me on.
You have been looking at, or perhaps you and your colleagues at Mercatus have been looking at the change in the use of 1099 forms for contracted employees over the past 15 years. What's happening there?
Yeah, so just to give a little context for why we've been looking at this issue is with the rise of, you know, what's commonly referred to as the sharing economy. This is companies like Uber, Lyft, TaskRabbit that are giving people opportunities to work that just didn't exist, let's say, 10 or 15 years ago. And this is really driving a major conversation with regard to what is the future of work look like. You know, are we all becoming a nation of freelancers? Is employment as we know it over? And what we decided to do was take a data-driven, objective approach to answering this question and say, really, given what we know about the data that we could get from the IRS, what do the trends over the last decade and a half look like with regard to independent work versus traditional employment? And what we found is that, you know, independent work as a percentage is increasing faster than W-2s. That is, the growth of the issuance of 1099 miscellaneous forms is growing faster year over year as a percentage than the issuance of W-2 forms.
And that should be some indication of some broader truth?
Yeah, I think, you know, particularly around the growth of the sharing economy, people have taken one of two approaches. Either the sharing economy is a drop in the bucket and it isn't affecting employment and independent work at all, or it's a major driver in independent work and it's changing the nature of work as we know it. But what we're seeing is that, yes, independent work is increasing, about a 22% increase since the year 2000. But a lot of that growth predates the advent of the sharing economy. So a lot of what we're seeing in the growth of independent work is predating the creation of firms like Uber, Lyft, or TaskRabbit, or others.
Well, I think what's happening, and I run a small business, and I've done so for 30 years, and I know many of the people who run small businesses, is you do everything you possibly can as a small business owner over the past, well, over the past 20 years, but certainly the past 6 years under the present administration, to avoid hiring a direct employee. When you hire a direct employee, you are buying into innumerable problems you can have as an employer in terms of statutory requirements that you may or may not meet. And by dumping it off as a 1099, you get the benefit of that person's contribution without the headache of his status being a statutory employee.
Yeah, and that's a point my colleague and co-author Eli Dorado has made recently, is that if for the most part, the recent recoveries from the two most recent recessions have been more or less jobless recoveries. That is, firms are shifting more toward contracting work than rehiring laid off workers. So that could explain some of this. Other explanations could be the growth in technology has allowed people to connect in ways that allow them to utilize contract work instead of needing to hire a full-time employee to accomplish the same task.
And you take a look at the Affordable Care Act, where if you have a statutory employee and he's doing more than 30 hours a week, boom, you're hit with potential fines, and no one knows what tomorrow brings in terms of how those fines for not supplying adequate insurance, adequate in the eyes of President Obama and his group. So why get involved? I mean, it used to be that you would hire employees because your business is growing and you're optimistic about the future, and that's a risk you take, but you know you can make it better down the road. It all comes together. But that's not the economy, at least small business, lives in today. And in fact, big business is burning the rubber off the tires, trying to get their facilities out of the country. So, but again, this isn't something the middle class did to themselves. This all comes out of the leadership in Washington.
And in many ways, I think, in particular, what we were looking at is the sharing economy and all the platforms and firms that make up the sharing economy. And in many ways, one can look at the sharing economy as an alternative for those people who have been excluded from traditional employment relationships. So those people who are actively seeking work but cannot find work, let's say, in in a traditional employment setting can now turn to independent work as an alternative and find opportunity that simply may have not existed, let's say 15 or even 20 years ago.
But in a healthy economy, again, what you want to do is you want to lock up your resources. You want to have the best location. You want to have the best tools. You want to have the best people. And if in a growing and an economy where you believe tomorrow will even be better than today, and today's a pretty good day, you want to do everything you can to keep together the essentials of your success. But when most people or many people view the economy as just a struggle to survive one day to the next, none of those things take place. People don't hire the fellow right out of college knowing that 3 and 4 years down the road, he will truly be able to pay his own way. He'll be able to contribute because of your investment over time. No one takes those chances. And then that's kind of a tone that comes out of Washington. And I'm not disagreeing with, the sharing economy and some of the new technologies as they allow people to take care of their own work needs on a subcontract basis. But there is a fund, in my opinion, there's a completely different tone and mood on the part of business owners, large and small, about what tomorrow holds in the United States today. I wish it wasn't a tone that people now hold, but it's not what it once was, where we will make a better country tomorrow. Now it's a matter of what will the government do to us next.
And, you know, over the course of the last 30 years, we have seen a downward trend in business dynamism. That is, you know, annual job creation rates are going down, annual job destruction rates are going down, and what you're seeing is a less dynamic traditional economy. And I think that's what's really creating opportunities. That, and also, just the rapid increase in technological innovation is creating opportunities for people to start up companies like Uber and Lyft and TaskRabbit and Instacart. But it's also creating opportunities for individuals that say may have sought opportunity elsewhere. In a fixed traditional employment setting, are now given an opportunity to work in a more flexible, independent setting that allows them to, let's say, pursue education or to pursue their own entrepreneurial efforts and allow them to use these services to smooth out their income over time. And again, find opportunity that just isn't present for them in the traditional employment environment.
No, it certainly provides some tools and mechanisms for people to kind of self-design their own personal work application in terms of how much time they want to spend working and how does it balance with the rest of their needs, whether it's education or childcare or looking after elderly parents. And these are all good things. But this long-term transition from W-2s to 1099s indicates that many businesses don't feel that the individual skill set that any given employee brings to the table is worth investing in, because there has consistently been a surplus of labor of all talents and all levels for some years, and that's why we see the middle class wages dropping, and it's not good. When you see the W-2s begin to grow faster than 1099s, you'll see that there is some solidifying in the health of business across the country, and people begin to lock in, so to speak, long-term employees for their long-term business prospects. Hey, Christopher, that's just my opinion, but would you stay with us through a break so we can continue this conversation on the flip side?
Sure, definitely. Thank you very much.
We're on the phone with Christopher Koopman. He's a research fellow at the Project for the Study of American Capitalism at the Mercatus Center. And we have a lively discussion about, what's happening with all these former W-2 people who are now on 1099s, meaning they're no longer direct employees. You stay with us. We are coming to you live from the Conservative Commandos Radio Network studios, WNJC 1360 AM, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world at a whole bunch of places on the Internet. You stay with us. We'll be back in 3 minutes.
I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I...
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding
to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard.
Businessman there, drink my wine.
You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
If you want to listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show, if you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to theleadingedgeradionetwork.com, or 1 p.m., log on to roarradio.net. At 2 p.m., log on to the this is a new one, so bear with me. Log on to highplainsdailynews.com. And now you can listen to the Conservative Commandos from any telephone on the planet by calling 832-999-1199. That's 832-999-1199. On the phone with us now is Christopher Koopman. He's a research fellow with the Project for the Study of American Capitalism at the Mercatus Center of George Mason University. We're talking about this emerging new economy. Fewer W-2 type employees and more 1099. My co-host Rick Trader has a question. How do you define, Christopher, how do you define the sharing economy? Give us some good examples.
Yeah, so I think the sharing economy in the broadest sense can be understood as any of these new firms and businesses popping up that connect individuals with one another to share things they already have with people who want to use those things. So I think the classic and most popular example at this point is Uber. Uber exists to connect people who own cars with people who want rides across town. So it's not a company investing in, at this point, cars themselves, buying cars and deploying them. But what it's investing is technology to connect individuals who own cars with individuals who want rides. And this goes across all sorts of different industries. You have things like TaskRabbit that, in essence, people can use their spare time, or Instacart, people can use their spare time to take on tasks and to do things for others that need help doing them. So with Instacart, for example, you can go on there and connect with individuals who actually do your grocery shopping for you. So it's allowing people to take what they have and put it to productive use. and make money from it. So you think Uber, Lyft, Airbnb, for example, allowing people to take their bedrooms or spare rooms and turn it into a profit opportunity. That, in a broadest sense, is what the sharing economy is. It's all of these new devices or these new platforms allowing people to connect in ways that they couldn't connect, let's say, 15 or 20 years ago.
However, the result of that connection is no different than it was 50 or 100 years ago when someone was looking for a room and they put up a little notice or someone was doing odd jobs in the neighborhood. Is that fair?
Exactly. In a lot of ways, this is simply just allowing people to do things that they've already been doing, but it's allowing them to do it in more efficient ways. It's overcoming those barriers that otherwise seemed insurmountable before the advent of the smartphone and the internet. And it's allowing people to find work in ways that they simply couldn't find before. And that was one of the driving reasons why we started this research into the growth of the 1099 forms, is to see how is this actually affecting the nature of work. Are we all becoming freelancers and independent contractors, or are the trends heading in another direction?
Rick Trader has a question for you, Christopher.
Christopher, thanks for joining us today here on the Conservative Commandos radio show. Christopher, I was wondering about the underground businesses. That the ones that are basically working, providing services like you're talking about, but are not filing a 1099. Do you see a rise in those also?
So we didn't look at that specifically, yeah. But I think some of the rise in the number of 1099s being issued is the idea that people are now using the internet and using these platforms to do, mm-hmm. I think, what you were calling underground businesses. And what it's doing is it's triggering 1099 reporting. So in some ways, it's bringing these jobs and these businesses out of the shadows and allowing people to do it within the system.
Mm-hmm. And also with the underground businesses, do you see that the government, just like the government now wants to tax the internet, do you see that government is going to look at this and scrutinize it a little bit?
Yes, I certainly do think that as the sharing economy broadly, but then specifically firms like Uber have grown in prominence in the media, is it's drawn more attention from policymakers. And you have seen ideas being floated both in local governments and at the federal government about how to respond to this, quote-unquote, growing 1099 workforce. But it is important to keep in mind in absolute terms, W-2 forms at this point still far outweigh 1099 forms. So while the number of 1099 forms as a percentage is growing, they'd have to continue at their current trend, the current linear trend, until 2082 before they would exceed W-2s. And with regard to your question about the internet tax, I believe Congress did just pass a law saying no internet.
Yeah, I was just using that as an example of how government responds to new things.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, that's all right. You know, I was just using that as an example to see, to ask that question. Do you think government might look and see, we're missing a large segment of people here who aren't paying taxes, who aren't filing either a W-2 or a 1099, and that because of the rise of the 1099s being filed, wow, there must be a bigger pot down there with underground businesses.
Yeah, so
people
working
out the books.
I'm not sure exactly how the IRS, in terms of taxes, is going to respond to, let's say, people not reporting income. But I can say that other agencies, in particular the Department of Labor, has begun to respond to what they see as the apparent growth of the 1099 workforce or the independent workforce, and have come out with new guidelines. I think recently they just said something to the effect of, almost every independent worker is being misclassified and almost everyone is in fact an employee, not an independent worker. So you have seen government respond to the new questions being brought up by the growth of independent work. But it's really important to keep in mind is that this is a trend that's been happening for a decade and a half. You know, the growth in 1099 miscellaneous forms, it's been going on for a decade and a half. And, you know, this most recent trend upward began under President Bush. This has gone over a course of administration, and it predates the sharing economy. So responding to the growth in independent work in the specific context of sharing economy platform may cause more harm than any of the benefits that would occur.
Well, I wouldn't see that. This is Kevin Wade again. It seems that people voluntarily make use of these platforms, these tools, to keep themselves busy, occupied, and generate some income. I don't know that if they had a plethora, a world of choices for other types of employment, whether they would still be making use of these platforms and these tools. But it certainly relieves some of the difficulties in the present economy that the present economy puts on the shoulders of too many Americans.
Oh, certainly. And I think in some ways, the growth of the sharing economy is allowing people to focus on their own entrepreneurial endeavors. I know something I like to do whenever I get into an Uber or Lyft is to ask the driver, what are they doing, in addition to this. Almost all of them have something else they're doing. If it's starting their own business, if it's going to school, if it's, looking for work elsewhere in a different industry, almost all of them are focused on something else, and the opportunities generated by platforms like Uber and Lyft are really providing them the type of flexibility and freedom to focus on the things they want to do rather than having to take a job or a employment in a sector or in an industry that they simply don't want to be in.
Christopher, we're hard up against the end of the segment. Could you give our audience a means to stay current with your writings and publications?
Yeah, so the best place to start would be mercatus.org, mercatus.org. That's the best place to start, and there's all sorts of research on a plethora of public policy issues there.
Christopher Koopman, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you so much for having me on.
If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com, or mornings at 9 a.m. log on to Leading Edge Radio Network, at 1 p.m. log on to roarradio.net, roarradio.net, and at 2 p.m. log on to High Plains Daily News. They all end in .com except for Roar Radio. I just explained that to you. And you can listen to the Conservative Commandos from any phone anywhere on the planet by calling 832-999-1199. I'm Kevin Wade. I'm joined by Rick Trader. We're going to have our final guest on this Monday the 14th come in just a few minutes. We're going to come back. We want you to be there for us.
I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I...
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos radio network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today, the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vyden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios. WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back, everybody, and welcome back, fellow patriots. Welcome back once again to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. I'm Rick Trader, along with Kevin Wade, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360, and around the world on the Internet. For rebroadcast of our shows, check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com. For mornings at 9 a.m., please log on to Leading Edge Radio Network. At 1 p.m., roarradio.net. And at 2 p.m., log on to highplainsdailynews.com. You can also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Kevin, we do have our next guest with us, and the honor of the introduction is yours.
Yeah, Larry Pratt is a longtime executive director of the Gun Owners of America. Now, this is a group who has one mission, and that one mission is to defend the Second Amendment and to preserve our right to keep and bear. And he's been fighting the good fight and carrying a proud message for almost three decades now with GOA, Gun Owners of America. And we are delighted to have him here with us on the phone here on this Monday afternoon. Larry, how are you today?
Delighted to be with you. Thanks so much for having me.
There has been an undercurrent of criticism of our Second Amendment rights because of these recent outbreaks of violence in some of our communities, outbreaks that would not have gone on so long if we had well-armed and well-trained citizens on the scene. But I'll let you pick up the story and walk us through what's been happening.
Well, it's a delight to finally have someone point to the problem right off the bat. The problem is, as you just said, there was nobody able to defend themselves on the scene. The latest massacre, public massacre in San Bernardino, just one of umpteen. In fact, all but two of our public massacres have occurred in gun-free zones, as it was in that venue in San Bernardino. So, yeah, there's a problem with the law, but the problem isn't that Americans have guns. The problem is the law specifically in too many places keeps Americans from having enough guns, and precisely guns with them when and where they need them.
Now, we have, I believe, failed leadership at the top, that instead of identifying the dangers of unreconciled Islamic terror in our homeland, they point to the Second Amendment and somehow find new and curious criticisms of it, when in fact that has been with us since the days of, at least in our hearts, since the days of Concord prior to the Revolution.
We've been dealing with elites that figured that they knew best, and if they suspected that they were not being received with 100% joy and unanimity, then they pass laws, try to use force of arms to impose their will on the people. And yes, it goes back actually even before Lexington and Concord, but that was a very notable benchmark in our history. It's usually considered the time when the colonists realized that they were at war. They'd had skirmishes leading up to that time, but that was indeed in many ways the shot that was heard around the world. And it should be kept in mind that that battle was fought over gun control.
Exactly.
The British troops were there on their way to Concord. They wanted to get rid of some pesky colonials in Lexington, but mainly they wanted to get the magazine in Concord that was housing ammunition and cannon that was owned by the colonial militia. And they didn't get to Concord that day. About a third of their British detachment, I guess it was called a regiment, a lot of guys, maybe 200 guys, were killed or wounded. And they were stunned. The British were absolutely stunned that a crack unit of the world's leading army got sent packing by a bunch of shirt-tail colonial militiamen who probably never formed a proper line when they began firing. They were probably ragged and relatively undisciplined, but they were doing one thing that was hard to beat. They were defending hearth and home.
They were defending hearth and home, kith and kin, and none of that would have taken place if the British tyrant had not tried to seize firearms from their lawful owners. Now, let's come forward 200-plus years. There's talk in the Obama administration about using today's no-fly list as a guide for seizing firearms from, again, honest, law-abiding American citizens. Where is this going?
Well, hopefully it's going nowhere. The no-fly list is, shall we say, not adequate for the task. How do you explain a list that has on it as a basis for not purchasing a gun, now deceased, but Senator Ted Kennedy was on that list for some time. Took him quite a bit of effort to get his name off that list. Ted Kennedy, senator from Massachusetts, was on the no-fly list. Now, that must make that list, I would think, a really valuable crime-fighting tool. As somebody, a talk show host here in Washington, D.C., Chris Plant, quipped the other day, I can see putting him on the no-drive list, but he had no business on the no-fly list.
Keep your daughter away from him, too. Larry Pratt, Rick Trader here. You know, when you're talking about taking guns from people on a no-fly list, this seems to be something a new tactic coming out of the left because of what happened in San Bernardino. But it seems like, Larry, whenever something like what happens in San Bernardino happens, you can see the path the two groups make. For instance, more people buy guns, then there are more people who want to control those guns.
And when you start talking about control and the no-fly list and whatever else pops into their head, the one thing they don't want to hear about is the fact that the venue at that inland center in San Bernardino mm-hmm. was a quote-unquote gun-free zone mm-hmm. where all of our public massacres, save two, have occurred since 1950. And somehow our wonderful leaders, who know so much more than we, continue insisting that gun-free zones are the way to handle crime and public massacres. Way to go, guys.
Well, Larry, I'm with you on that. I'm thinking that people should really be leery about going in a gun-free zone because they're Amen. Putting a big bullseye on their back.
It's a very dangerous thing to do. It's one thing that I've been willing to do with my eyes open mm-hmm. at airports because they've spent a great deal of money in the construction of their gun-free zones. But setting up a magnetometer at one point to force people through that just doesn't solve the problem. And if they think that's a secure a move for security, they really don't understand the problem they're dealing with. And then they assume that, oh, we can declare it a gun-free zone. We got the magnetometer. Everything's cool. Well, everything's not cool.
Hey, Larry, we got to take a quick break. Could you stay with us, please?
You betcha.
All right, for just 2 minutes. And you are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with Kevin Waite and Rick Trader, coming to you from the studios of the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, TalkStream Live, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, Rebooting Liberty Radio Network, AM/FM 24/7, and a bunch of others. Don't go away. Our guest this segment is Larry Pratt. He's the Executive Director of Gun Owners for America. Be right back.
I really don't care. That's my prerogative. They say I'm nasty, but I...
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard.
Businessman there, to drink my wine.
You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
And welcome back to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with Kevin Waite and Rick Trader. And for rebroadcast of our shows, you can check out our websites, CCRShow.com or CCRSNetwork.com, or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to LeadingEdgeRadioNetwork.com, at 1 p.m., RoarRadio.net, at 2 p.m., log on to HighPlainsDailyNews.com. But you can also hear our show from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Our guest this segment is Larry Pratt. He's the Executive Director for Gun Owners of America. Larry, thanks for holding through that break. We appreciate your time.
Appreciate being with you. Thanks for having me.
Oh, we always love having you, Larry. You know that. Larry, you know, one of the big debates that we see coming from the left after these types of incidences is gun control. They also want to control the size of the magazine a rifle or a weapon can hold. Larry, when I see the firepower coming from these terrorists or these mass shooters, a six-shot revolver really doesn't match up much anymore, does it?
Well, not in the real world, but if you are thinking...
Better than nothing, but...
with a mindset of the anti-self-defense crowd, the anti-gun crowd, we know that every bullet that is fired strikes a lethal blow anywhere in the general area that it's actually been intended. Mm-hmm. And six would be enough. I mean, six people, six deaths, how much more do you want? Mm-hmm. Of course, the problem is that in the real world, the first six shots could miss entirely, could not, perhaps won't be disabling, mm-hmm. Even if some of them were to hit. And so what do you do? You're busy reloading while somebody's aiming for your head. Mm-hmm. Not really a good plan, but then these folks don't study what we do know about defensive shooting uses of firearms, what's involved in a firefight, and so they make up things out of their fantasy world that unhappily don't fit the real world, and they will be the reason people lose their lives if their restrictions aren't overcome.
Larry, we're really getting into this election season, and I was wondering if you could, for our audience, talk for a minute about the candidates, both the Democrat and the Republican candidates, and what is your opinion on their views about gun control?
Well, the Democrats are likely to nominate Hillary Clinton. They would all agree with her substantially on gun control. And that is, she let the cat out of the bag, frankly, when she endorsed the Australian approach. Mm-hmm. Australia banned all semi-automatic long guns and handguns. That resulted in the confiscation of a huge number of firearms. A similar move in the United States would result in a proportionately even a much larger confiscation of those kinds of firearms. And it gets us back to the discussion we were just having about what happens when your six shots and your revolver are gone and you are still under attack. Oh, you can reload. Yeah, right. Lots of luck. Some guys are fast in doing that. I'm not. You know, I don't spend my day at the range, which you'd almost have to do to be one of those speed reloaders. So in the real world, those of us that are serious about self-defense want a gun with a magazine that's easily detachable and reinsertable, so that if, God help us, something of that magnitude results, we can take care of business the way the Korean merchants did during the Los Angeles riots and the way other people have been able to in similarly very dangerous situations. The idea that somehow you've limited your firepower ahead of time is only an idea that could appeal to the universal disarmament crowd, be they talking foreign policy or domestic policy. So the Democrats have pretty well put on a Halloween mask to scare everybody in terms of their Second Amendment firearms policies. Among the Republicans, we've chosen Ted Cruz for an endorsement, the senator from Texas. We very much like the fact that when he even takes on his own establishment, he doesn't blink. So that when Ted Cruz says he's going to try to do something, he may not succeed, but he will not sell you out in the process. He will stick to his point and do everything he can to make his point and to push it. And even while losing in some of these issues that he's taken up, he's shown the hand of the Republican establishment and shown them for being the people that campaigned one way, mm-hmm. and then when they had the votes to legislate another way, we were just kidding. So we've endorsed Cruz. We think that if he were the nominee, he would be the most likely, actually, to get elected. And the idea of him debating Hillary Clinton, oh, man, I want to sell tickets to that one. Mm-hmm. and that, I think, would be the road to the White House. And right now, he's coming on very strong in Iowa. And I think in part it's because he's got what one columnist out there, Steve Dace, spelled like Dace, D-E-A-C-E, Steve Dace has compared him to Reagan in putting together the three legs of the Republican base, the Republican stool, foreign policy, domestic control of spending, and strong on social issues, including guns. Mm-hmm. And those three overlapping but somewhat different constituencies are what Reagan rode, if you will, as a horse to the White House. And at least in Iowa, Cruz is rising very strong now and likely has taken a lead that might be insurmountable.
Larry, we're speaking with Larry Pratt. He is the Executive Director of Gun Owners for America. Larry, we only have about 2-3 minutes left. But I wanted you to talk about Trump, and I wanted to talk you to talk about Carson and Christie as far as their ideas on guns, Second Amendment rights.
Well, Christie ultimately did the right thing when Jeanine Allen was incarcerated because she had a gun in New Jersey. Bless her heart, she thought that having a concealed carry permit that she had in Pennsylvania was good in New Jersey, and it turns out nothing's good in New Jersey. Poor gal.
Believe me, I know that I'm here.
I know, and you're behind enemy lines.
Larry, do you think what Christie did there, because Christie in the past has said he's for some gun control, do you think that was election theatrics more than
very likely
really feels?
It took him a long time to come around to letting her out of jail. He finally did. I'm glad he did.
And yeah.
I'll tell him thank you very much. But I think the length of time tells us something about, well, maybe I should. I guess, you know. And he finally made the right decision, to his credit. So, you know, one for the governor. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, you put two other names on the table.
Carson and Trump.
Carson, I think, has begun to fade. I like him. He's a very likable guy. Man, if I were a patient, I'd want to have a doctor just like
Carson. Well, I see him more suited for a surgeon general than for president. But
I can think of a lot of places that he would do an excellent job.
But as far as Second Amendment, you know, what he's talked about, Second Amendment rights.
He's had a little trouble getting the right focus, and at one point he thought semi-automatics were only for people in rural areas. He's since walked that back, to his credit, but he wasn't there to start with, and that's something that I think we're interested in. And actually the same with Trump. While he does have a license to carry in New York, which is impressive and probably helps that he's a billionaire, that he was able to have somebody bird dog that thing, because they do not make it easy. I have to tell you, you guys broadcasting not far from the heart of the beast there. His attitude seems to be somewhat, well, let's, you know, we can have some controls over those semi-automatic rifles. And I don't know, his thinking's kind of a mishmash. Essentially, he's on the right side, more or less, generally speaking, on the Second Amendment issue, obviously be an upgrade over Hillary Clinton or what's in there now, but I don't think he really gets it the way Senator Cruz does.
Larry Pratt, Executive Director of Gun Owners of America, I want to thank you so much for joining us. Larry, please tell our audience where they can go for more information on Gun Owners of America.
We're at gunowners.org, and if you go there, you can sign up for our free legislative alerts. It was that system and the folks that got them and acted on them that killed gun control coming out of the Sandy Hook massacre, it was members of Gun Owners of America, with the information we were getting them, that took care of business. So it's a great place to get action information.
And we must be eternally vigilant on our constitutional rights. Larry Pratt, thank you so much. Take care. God bless and Merry Christmas.
And God bless you all. Thank you so much for having me on.
By the way, don't forget, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, we're going to have very special shows here on the Conservative Commandos radio show and network. If you have some of your favorite Christmas song parodies you would like to play, please send them to me at rick@conservativecommandosradioshow.com or connect with me on Facebook, Rick Trader, or on Twitter. But for right now, we're out of time. We got to run. We got to go. Take care. God bless. We'll see you tomorrow on the radio.
1360 AM WNJC Washington Township Philadelphia.
They say I'm nasty.